যাচ্ছেন, এটা আমার হয়ে গেল। বোরিয়া ইজ অ্যাভেলেবল টু সাইন কপিজ অফ হিজ বুক অ্যাট দ্য বুক স্টোর অ্যান্ড ইউ ক্যান টেক দিস ডিসকাশন অফলাইন টু দি অথার্স লাউঞ্জ বিফোর উই স্টার্ট দ্য নেক্সট প্রোগ্রাম। সিন্স ইট ইজ অ ডিফার্ড লাইভ টেলিকাস্ট অন NDTV অ্যাট 9 PM, উই উইল বি টেকিং জাস্ট অবাউট 5 মিনিটস টু সেট আপ দ্য স্টেজ অকর্ডিং টু টেলিভিশন স্টিপুলেশনস। We request you to bear with us until then, and we will be starting very shortly. Thank you for your patience. We are almost ready to start. Before we begin, may I invite on stage Mr. Chanakya Chaudhary, Group Director, Corporate Communication and Regulatory Affairs, Tata Steel, to deliver his vote of thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome to the last session, the grand finale. It's a pleasure to have brought together the intellects of Calcutta, young and old, together to the Tata Steel Calcutta Literary Meet 2016, which, as I'm told by some of my friends and colleagues here, is now rated among the top 2 events, literary events in the country today. Tata Steel is indeed privileged to partner one of the such coveted events in Calcutta's literary calendar. It's been a five and a half days, as Malvika puts it, of intense exchange of ideas ranging from culture, art, and including comedy, which we saw yesterday, which was amazing. Tata Steel, the flagship company of the Tata Group, believes in promoting sports, art, and culture and literature as a responsible corporate citizen and amongst its brand. Therefore, it is our endeavor to bring best-in-class experience in literary enthusiasts and provide a knowledge platform for an intellectual exchange of views in distinguished literary minds of the society on contemporary issues. On behalf of Tata Steel, I take this opportunity to thank each and every one of you who's present here and some of us who could not come in today for this, in this historic city and this iconic venue, Victoria. To all the enthusiasts who have taken part to make it a great success, and my sincere gratitude to, first of all, the authorities of Victoria Memorial, Jantada, who's here, he's a great friend, and thanks a lot for giving all the venue to us as such, and in providing all the facilities that you have done so far, and the government of West Bengal, the local administration, the media, which has covered it, all the events so well, and the unstinted support which each one of you, the Calcuttans of this, the Calcuttans as such, who have given this event such a great, I would say such a great, they've embraced this event for all of us. Thank you so much, and we'll like to make it bigger as we go forward. Have a great evening and a great year ahead. Thank you so much.
Another quick vote of thanks from the festival director, Malavika Banerjee.
The shortest vote of thanks. So I'd like to thank all of you at the start. I didn't know the meaning of SRO till today. It's standing room only. So thank you for making this an SRO event. It means a lot to us. I'd like to thank our partners, Standard Chartered, SREI, ITC, Exide, Telegraph, our afterwards partner, 100 Pipers, and above all, Victoria Memorial. A big applause to all our sponsors and my team at Gameplan, who have been enslaved to this event for the last month. Thank you, and keep reading. That's what we want you to do. Thank you. Have a great finale here.
All right, if you can all settle down, then we'll start. What's happened at the back? Let's just settle down. You can't see. Please, if you could settle down there, then we can start. You're blocking people at the back and it's kind of disturbing us. Okay, please, everybody settle down at the cameras. If you can just kneel down a bit, it would really help. Oh gosh, okay. As we mark Republic Day, it is a day for commemoration, but is it also a day for some introspection? Tonight, we're at the stunningly beautiful Victoria Memorial in Kolkata, coming to you from the Kolkata Literary Meet. The Republic Day is meant to be about constitutional principles, the magicians of the architects of the Indian Republic. But what does the phrase idea of India mean anymore? Has it just become a cliche? Or has it become a contested narrative? Do we follow and cherish all our constitutional principles? And what about that most cherished principle of all, that is at the heart of a republic and a democracy, freedom? That is what we'll be talking about over the next 40 to 50 minutes with a wonderful panel and an even more wonderful Kolkata audience. So let me introduce our guest on this panel today, Javed Akhtar, who is of course a man of so many parts that I think he needs no introduction at all. Swapan Dasgupta, somebody whom I personally enjoy sparring with very, very much, one of our brightest sparks. Let's have a big round of applause for him. Nandana Sen, a woman of many parts. We've seen her as an actress, but she's just become a writer of books for children. And Mambi the monkey, for those who don't know. And, of course, the best for last, the man beloved by so many different generations, Ruskin Bond. You know, Ruskin Bond is 81 years old, but I actually think he's 17, which is the age at which he first wrote about Rusty. So a special round of applause for Ruskin Bond. Let me start by asking all of you what this day, what the idea of the Republic actually means to all of you. And I'll start with you, Ruskin, if I may. 26 January, we're celebrating the Republic. What is at the heart of the idea of the Republic?
I guess it's it's to celebrate, in a way, the tremendous diversity and richness of the rich heritage of our country. And so it's, I think, a day for celebration, and today, just coming here in the evening and looking at the crowds, all the families who were out on the streets, on the Maidan, at the Victoria Memorial, also happy and enjoying themselves, and not even I couldn't see any signs of any conflict or disagreement or unpleasantness anywhere. So you could see that at least in Kolkata, people are celebrating Republic Day.
And yet, Swapan, this has been the year of contested narratives around the idea of India, around the Republic, around the concept of freedom. And what I really want to talk about today is freedom. I mean, these words, tolerance, intolerance, they've now become as politicized as other words. So let's talk about freedom. Do you believe, and I ask you this because you wrote a very interesting piece saying that more Indians today want to...
Significance of 26 January. 26 January, the significance is this was ideally earmarked as the Independence Day in 1930. Hmm. And by a quirk of circumstances, we got August 15th as our Independence Day, which is rather inhospitable weather. So I think this is far more agreeable. Now, what is significant about 26 January?
Yeah.
On August 15, we got political sovereignty, the right to determine our own future. What 26 January meant was, what are the rules by which we govern our public life? What are the broad sets of parameters on which? And the larger ideas of freedom, of democracy, of a basic of acceptance of diversity are very much inbuilt. But what we've seen in the past few years, and basically, and it starts with this so-called idea of India, which you love to tom-tom so much, because I don't know if there's a single idea.
I actually didn't tom-tom it. I said there are multiple narratives around it.
As long as the word multiple is used.
Multiple.
Because there is no one idea of India. You ask five people in this audience, especially their Bengalis, they won't get a single uniform idea.
Yeah.
You will always get different ideas. Now, therefore, constitution is just one set of ideas.
But isn't it the paramount, big, platonic idea within which all other ideas have to find existence? And I ask this because something has to have sanctity when a nation is born and then has to, you know, be governed.
To my mind, what is paramount is the idea of Indianness. the belief
as
in India.
As different from the idea of India.
As the idea of Indianness. And we may have different ideas of Indianness. But as long as we are committed to the ideas, the constitution. Now, I was in Jaipur and my friend Shashi Tharoor and I had a debate on, he wanted the presidential form of government. Now, the presidential form of government, you would say, is completely averse to what the constitution says. Am I going to say that, look, you don't have any faith in the basic notions of democracy and freedom? No. So constitutional patriotism is just one facet. You agree with the rules. You think that some other rules are better?
Yeah.
If you want sort of proportional representation in parliament, that might be good for some people if you don't want that. So let's not fetishize constitutional patriotism. It was fetishized in places like Germany because after the war, in Germany, they just didn't want to accept what was their national identity prior to 1945.
But
now, India, we do not have any problems on that count.
But the point is, Swapan, there might also be multiple notions of what national identity is as well, not just constitutional patriotism or the idea of India. You know
we are sitting in
Victoria
Memorial. It was built by Lord Curzon, a person, a viceroy with whom the Bengalis may have exceptional fascination for other reasons. But we take Victoria Memorial and whatever it meant,
yes,
and apply it in today's context and mean it in whatever way. Maybe it's just a recreation ground.
Yeah.
It may not be the symbol of empire any longer, as he meant it.
Things,
so that's precisely
evolve.
The point. Things evolve. Let's not get static about it. The most important thing is it also a memorial to a facet of India that also reflects our Indianness. And that, to my mind, is most important.
Javed Saab, if this is true, why have we had such a discordant debate in the last many months over the notion of constitution, what is sacred, which principles are sacred, which principles can never be compromised on? It seems a very raucous environment for public debate.
With all due respect, I would disagree with Swapan Saab on one point. No idea can have more credibility, legal or moral, more than the Constitution. That's not possible. It is the rule book. You can have different games. You can play your games. Any game is played by two teams. And two teams are trying to defeat each other. They have different points of view. They have different goals.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there is a rule book. If you have any problem with the rule book, yes, like Mr. Shashi Tharoor thinks that the rule book should say there should be a president. But as long as the rule book has not accepted it, as long as it is not amended, you cannot say we will have one president.
Yeah.
It's not possible.
Yeah.
So the supremacy of the Constitution has to be accepted on every idea. You can have ideas within the premise of the Constitution. The Constitution can change. It can be amended. But whatever the Constitution is at any point of time, you have to respect that. Otherwise, you'll be in anarchy. Nobody can say that the Constitution will remain the same, but I will not accept it. That's not possible. No idea is more sacred, no idea is more credible, more respectable, and more Indian than the Constitution.
I'll get Swapan to come in on that later, but Nandana, your notion of freedom, and because it's become such a hotly debated construct these days, and, we have seen the tolerance versus intolerance debate actually politically polarize the conversation. We want this to not be about political parties, but as an individual, do you feel free to speak your mind without somebody coming after you for having an opinion?
I insist upon it. Yeah. But I feel certainly that there are many unfreedoms at work.
Unfreedoms,
now.
Interesting
yes.
word. Yeah.
And I think we're grappling for words constantly these days because so many words are called into question. But I do, we spoke about various things already, and to me today, happy Republic Day, everybody, by the way. It is a celebration of the Constitution, and I agree with Javed Saab that that is the heart of the India that I have known. It is a celebration of equality, of fraternity, of justice, and to me, most importantly, of liberty, freedom of expression, of thought, of faith, of religion. If we just think about what has happened in the last, since Republic, you know, in the last 12 months, in fact, start going back to the beginning of the year, that has come under so much threat, and we've all spoken about it in different ways.
So give an example of something that you believe has been different in the last year that it wasn't before.
I think the concentrated attack on free thinkers, starting with, in this year we have had, of course, Pansare's killing, we have had Kalburgi's killing, we have had the attack on Kulkarni. Just a couple of days ago, almost a similar attack happened on Varadarajan in Allahabad. There has been the silencing of Murugan. Very recently, there has been the criminalization of Arundhati Roy. So I think the concentration with which all of, and it's not that, I mean, Arundhati was taken to court for sedition 5 years ago. So I'm not saying that it is all happening now. And I'm not saying that there has never been cases of intolerance in India. That would be very selective memory, and I would not wish to subscribe to that.
Okay.
But I think that something has happened since in the last year, since our celebrating Republic Day a year ago, that is very disturbing to me.
Okay, so many different examples there. We'll debate some of them. But Ruskin Bond, you just joined Twitter. At the young age of 81, you decided to get onto Twitter. Why was that? Before I ask you what you said about what you're going to say there, what brought you to Twitter?
My readers, actually. It wasn't... I hadn't thought of it until...
people told you to do so.
Yes, I was told to do so.
But you said, I'm going to think and be very careful about what I tweet. Now, I was a bit curious to know why you said that. Like, you know, everybody loves you. What could you possibly say that, doesn't everybody love him? Yes, everybody loves you. So
I love all of you too, but it's hard to make love to everybody at the same time.
Why would you know, the beloved of so many generations, have to worry about what you say on Twitter?
No, I don't worry about what I say here or at home or in my own writings. But Twitter, somehow, I've always felt it's a little... People are sometimes inclined to go overboard on Twitter.
Yes.
I think, have to sometimes restrain myself from perhaps saying something that I might regret.
Because you think people will kind of get after you for it.
No, nobody's ever got after me for anything, except when I was a schoolboy. I've never had that kind of problem. But because I've never really gone out of my way to upset anyone. Let's say, put it that way.
And why is that? Everybody, we all have opinions that upset somebody.
Yes, but you can have opinions and put them over in a gentle way, in a reasonable way, in a humorous way, and you can influence people without perhaps hitting them on the head with a hammer.
Now, Javed Saab, you said to me, I remember a few months ago, that if you had to write Sholay today, there is one particular scene, the temple scene, which you would not write because you said in this environment, God knows who's going to take offense, which really brings us to the notion of personal liberty. Now, I would argue that actually personal liberty has always been compromised in this country, and over the decades, we can find many examples. But you have a counter narrative from Nandana who thinks that this has happened in the last year. More accentuated.
I didn't say it has happened in the last year, but I think it has become disturbingly evident in the last year.
Javed Saab, why would you not write that Sholay scene and tell our audience what scene that is?
I think, let me begin from...
The beginning.
The very beginning, a very good place to start. So,
the sound of music. Yes.
I think...
Yes.
When such discussions are in the society or these controversies are there, we tend to take extreme stance. And when we take extreme stance, the truth falls between those two proverbial stools. There are people who say intolerance has risen to a dangerous level in the society. I don't believe it. There are people who say there is no intolerance in the society. I don't believe that either.
Yes.
The fact is somewhere in between.
Yes.
The fact is that society is and always was, Indian society, Indian ethos, was tolerant and is tolerant. The fact is there are certain segments of society, there are certain groups, and they always were there. Sometimes they become slightly bolder, sometimes they shy away, sometimes some other group becomes stronger, and so on and so forth. But if you see the history of last 67, 68 years, you will know that there was always some kind of an attack on freedom of expression. And particularly being in films, I am aware of it. You see, you can write an article about anything. You can make a speech in a seminar. Nobody is going to stop you. But same thing cannot be said in a documentary. Same thing cannot be said in a feature film. Not today. Always. It was always like that. Because the powers that be have been very clever. They know if it is written in an English magazine, there are very few people will read it, no problem. Let them have their fun. But if it comes in a movie, it will reach people. Now, this discretion was extremely matured and very, very clever. People are becoming less clever because they try to stop those who don't matter anyway.
Like who? Who doesn't matter who is being stopped?
You.
I'm not being stopped. No, because nobody can stop me. I may not matter. But no,
that's
can't
why
be
they
stopped.
Don't stop you. The day you will matter, they will stop you.
No, but seriously.
So what happens? You know. Why should I name them? So you,
I already
of course
named
you know
some
them.
Of them.
Who are you naming? He's saying people who matter.
As a matter of fact, sometimes it becomes unreasonable. And it is happening from the group that or from the side that it never used to happen.
Which is?
Now, if I said, I'll tell you. If I said that in 1975, I showed a comedy scene in a temple, today I won't. But even in 1975, I wouldn't have shown this scene in a mosque. Because that level of intolerance was there. Now the other one is matching it. That's about all.
So you are suggesting that Hindus are the Hindu community is becoming or sections of it is becoming extremist
now
like the Muslims.
Now they are joining the club.
Yeah.
They should not. It's a tragedy.
Yeah. That's Swapan, would you agree with that?
And again, don't say Hindus. That is a wrong representation.
So what should
not
I say?
Not Hindus. Some Hindu group. There is
some
a difference.
I said Hindu
the
extremists. Yeah.
The same Hindus have made a film like PK a super hit. I really wonder if in any Islamic country you would make same kind of film with taking Muslim symbols, this picture would become a super hit.
So what I'm hearing Javed Saab say is that the group, as he calls it, which never showed signs of fundamentalism today, is aping Muslim fundamentalists. Is that what you're saying?
Oh, yes.
You're saying that?
They are.
Look, Barkha, I think what we've heard now is that we've been told that in the past 12 months or so, maybe 18 months, the climate of India has suddenly undergone a vicious change, that something different has happened in India. Now, what has happened which certain people don't like? One, we got a government they didn't want. By and large, the people who control the media, the people who control the intellectual establishment of India, do not like Narendra Modi.
And vice versa.
Vice
he doesn't
versa,
like them
maybe.
Either.
Vice versa.
Yeah.
But they did their damnedest to try and stop it. When they couldn't, they raised the bogey of intolerance. Salman Rushdie's Satanic Verses was not banned by Narendra Modi. He was not a figure of any consequence then. The ethnic cleansing of Kashmiri Pandits in 1989 didn't happen when Narendra Modi was there. Now, this is far, to my mind, a far more serious offense than someone having a bottle of ink put on his head.
I think, therefore, we have
to look at it. When political opposition starts masquerading as defense of civil liberties, I think there is a problem. But I think Javed Saab has a point. There is now a section among the Hindus who think, why should we not be equally empowered like the mullahs?
Equally unreasonable.
Equally unreasonable. And I think he's right. Some of those creatures who go around flaunting letterheads and who invariably get television cameras to go after them. Now, there's a group in Kanpur which used to exist. Every Valentine's Day, some old man would get up and say, Bhartiya parampara ka khilaf hai. And, you know, intolerance is broken out. Now, this is what intolerance is. Certain intellectuals in India feel that their leverage over the power structure has
come
down.
Are you being fair here, Swapan? Because while you may disagree with certain intellectuals who chose to return their award, why question their integrity? Why make it about their control over the system?
They used to think that they had a monopoly over wisdom. When competitive voices who challenge their wisdom and say, look, we too have a different point of view.
Javed Saab, briefly, then Nandana, then Ruskin.
Swapan Saab, you have made a statement which is contradicting itself. I'll tell you how. On one hand, you say it is just a propaganda by the leftists or the liberals or the so-called intellectuals. On the other hand, you are saying that there are certain groups who are saying we should also be empowered as much as the mullah. They are not compatible statements. Either it is happening, if it is happening because of any reason, that is a different thing. Or it is not happening. If it is not happening, it is only propaganda. But you yourself are accepting it is happening and you are giving the reason why it is happening. Okay, reason is accepted. But the fact remains that it is happening. You have accepted it.
Yes, it is happening. There are some people who go around brandishing talwars. Now the question is, have these groups always existed? Today, what is the reason why you think
that couple of guys
carrying some saffron pagri on their head has today vitiated the atmosphere to such an extent that we can't have a festival like this. Everybody speaks their own mind
Nandana
in festivals.
Let Nandana come in. Nandana, I think the question is, because you're the one person who took the position that since the last Republic Day to this Republic Day, something has changed. And you feel that it used to happen before.
Something has intensified. I mean, Dambhokar happened years ago. And of course, we are all agreed on the fact that there have been intolerances in India. And there has also, at the same time, been a very long and strong tradition of tolerance, which is the way where I locate Indian identity.
Yes.
And to me, you cannot separate Indianness from India.
Yes.
And I am someone who believes in constitutional patriotism as opposed to the other kinds of patriotism that I am encountered with today. But I have a question for you. You're right, of course, about Salman Rushdie's book being banned. You're right about everything that you said, all the examples that you gave. But my question is, because we made mistakes in the past, should we condone mistakes in the present?
Certainly not. Yeah. Every time anybody gets up and say, for example, would it threaten you?
That has happened to me.
Okay, it has happened to you. It's completely unacceptable. You may have views which I may find unpalatable, but certainly there is a civilized way in which different views
can be encountered.
But
Swapan, isn't civilized anymore?
Barkha, let's
not connect it to BJP, Congress. Forget that.
Yeah, you mentioned the word.
No, I never mentioned the word. I never mentioned the word. I'm saying, let's not... You actually brought in Modi into this conversation.
Yeah, because I said, what has changed?
No,
Do you think those who voted for Modi have not been as disturbed by the events that have happened in the last 12 months?
I'm sure that
when a cacophony of voices say that today India has been Talibanized. I mean, what Talibanized? I mean, just look around you and ask yourself the question, in what substantial measure has your freedom to rubbish governments, to praise people, to give galleys of all descriptions on Twitter or something else, been compromised?
But you know, Swapan,
one thing that has happened. I'll tell you, Barkha, what has happened is that today, each time you, for instance,
me as in Barkha,
Barkha Dutt, has a narrative on Kashmir.
Yes.
Now you recall the old days when I used to say Barkha is the
voice
of the Hurriyat.
Yes.
I think there are 10 people now also willing to say, look, you don't, what you're saying is not entirely correct. And that's the difference. There is now different voices being heard rather than just one consensus.
I will say one thing though, that if you see this entire conversation around tolerance, intolerance, why are people feeling so hesitant to say what they think? What I mean is, why isn't Aamir Khan having to clarify? We could disagree totally. But he's clarifying. Shah Rukh is thinking that, oh, maybe my film partly didn't do well because I said whatever I did. You actually have people in public space saying, aajkal bahut careful rehna padta hai.
Javed has explained why.
But.
Film mein kyun hota hai?
But is there a reductionism entering our public discourse? Now, one of the ways that disagreement, Ruskin, was manifested was in a spate of writers returning their awards, which came to be known as award wapsi. You said, I loved my award and I'm not going to give it back. Tell us a little bit about that and why that award meant so much to you that you didn't actually want to join the award wapsi side of it.
I don't see why I should give my awards back. I worked hard for them. And in fact, when all this business of returning awards happened, I had 2-3 telephone calls asking me why I hadn't returned mine.
Who called you?
They were anonymous calls.
Yes,
they were.
Oh, okay.
And that made me even more determined that I wasn't going to return them, I'm afraid. And in any case, poor old Sahitya Academy, you can't really blame them. They're not powerful people or who can go around, you know, stopping writers being attacked and murdered.
They can't. You believe they can't stop writers from being attacked?
Not the academy. The government can.
Yeah.
But also, what I'd like to bring out is that in recent years, the media, especially the visual media, the television, has become so all-pervasive and all-powerful that incidents that in the past, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, atrocities took place. There was intolerance. There a lot of very unpleasant things happened, but we didn't always hear about them. There was no television. Even newspapers didn't have correspondents in small towns. So very often things happened which the public at large didn't hear about, or they were hushed
up. So you're saying it's...
So it's now everything is in front of you, I mean.
That's an important point, but just personally, what did that Sahitya Academy Award mean to you at a personal level? Because you've said the poor academy couldn't really stop this. So what did this award mean to you?
Well, it came at a time when, let's say, I was broke and not getting much recognition. So it helped. It helped me on my way. So I think I owe them a debt of gratitude.
Javed Saab, when Nayantara Sehgal and others did return their awards, I read somewhere that you said, I can understand her anguish. That doesn't mean you agree. That doesn't mean you agree with her decision, but you understood her anguish. But this debate around award wapsi has got so, not just politicized, it's divided your industry. In your industry, there is the Anupam Kher and the Madhur Bhandarkar and
Padma
the Ashok
Bhushan,
Pandit. Padma recipient Anupam Kher. You have Karan Johar on the other hand saying, he said at Jaipur, that freedom is a joke. Swapan, are you making faces because you don't agree?
No, I don't think he quite said that. He says, look, I don't want to get into
it. No, he said every time I say something, there's an FIR against me.
Which doesn't mean
that. That has become a musibat. It's become an ordeal to say something. You'll offend somebody, they'll come after you, and so on. What is happening in the industry? We've never seen this. The film industry is so divided on these issues.
I mean, we also live in a democracy. And we are citizens of a democratic country, so we have all the right to disagree with each other.
But you know, Anupam Kher took out a tolerance march, for
very,
example.
Very, very, eerie if the whole film industry had one opinion.
No, usually they express no opinion. So people like you are exceptions.
As a matter of fact, some of them have no opinion. Even today they have no opinion. But many of them have different opinions. It's totally understandable. But how do we define, I mean, this is tolerance, this is intolerance, the tolerance has reduced, the intolerance is increasing. How? What is the parameter? What is the scale? How do you judge that? I think the simple thing is, as long as you are dissenting, you are criticizing, you are saying anything offensive, within the parameter, within the boundaries that are provided by the Constitution, if you are doing something which is constitutionally allowed to you, it is not intolerance. The moment you go out of the constitutional right, you are intolerant, you may have done it because of any reason. You cannot justify that I was instigated. They had said such outrageous thing. That is why I have done something which is illegal, which is not constitutionally allowed to me. That is intolerance, period. People have made, in recent years, earlier also, made strange statements, some outrageous statements. Okay, they can be contradicted. There is, we have a hate speech rule, law in our country. We can go to the court. But you can't go and burn his house or hit him or burn the theater where his film is running. That is not done. That is intolerance. You disagree with the person, sue him, have file an FIR against him. That is right.
But do you believe people are being commercially penalized for holding opinions? You see, the one of the things that...
No, I have the right to commercially penalize somebody. If I don't like that person, I won't read his book or I won't see his film. I have that right. But I can't stop others to read that book. I cannot stop others to see the movie. That is not legally allowed. I have the right. So I don't like the face of this person, so I won't read
But
it.
On these awards, before I get Swapan in, you didn't answer that. On Nayantara Sehgal, you said, I understand her anguish. But you know, you heard a counter view from Ruskin Bond that this is, you know, returning awards.
I did not return. I also have an Academy Award. I have not returned it. Because I know that this award was given to me by some writers. So why should I humiliate them?
Yes,
this is not given to me by
consisted of writers, actually.
Any established by any bureaucrat or policeman. I did not do that. But I understand Nayantara Sehgal, at least we must give this margin, must not have done it because she wants some publicity or she wants a name on television or in newspapers. Perhaps she felt this is the way she can protest. All right, doesn't matter.
I think, Swapan, that's the hub of the debate, that, you know... You may not agree with them, you as in you, Swapan, or somebody
I
else.
I certainly don't.
You don't. But why impute motive? Why say, oh, this is because this is the way these people are trying to remain relevant or because they want to be in the news? You know, a lot of this vilification today takes place just for somebody holding an opinion.
Look, there is a lot of vilification of Anupam Kher because he did a tolerance march. So let's not say that...
Javed Saab, do you think it's a comparable example that Anupam Kher has also been vilified?
Maybe to some extent, yes. Because there are many people who think that that is why he has been given the award. I don't agree. He's a very fine actor. But Padma Bhushan was given to him, I mean, so very quickly after this protest march that he had. But
so you are saying that you see a connection?
No, I'm not saying it.
Aapne na kehte kehte.
I'm not saying it. I'm only saying that people, they think that the bridge is very small. So that's about all.
Swapan. So this is the thing, that today we are unable to separate people from broader politics.
Nayantara Sehgal has every right to protest or say it any way she feels like. Just as Ashok Bajpayee, when he had nothing to return, now returned an honorary doctorate for Hyderabad University. Now, he has every right to do so. I have every right to claim that, look, Ashok Bajpayee, I think your motives are not as clean as you make them out to be.
And I believe some writers want to take their awards back again.
Thank you, Ruskin.
So the point is, going beyond the award vapsi, Nandana, what do you think has made somebody like you, you're also your father's daughter, you're Amartya's daughter, who's a much debated... much debated public figure, with people either lining up to support him or lining up to criticize him. How does that play out at a personal level for you?
I'm my mother's daughter as well.
Yes, that's true. That is fairly said and absolutely acceptable. Absolutely.
And I think both of them have spoken out very clearly and strongly about all that has been disturbing to them. And as a daughter and as an Indian, I find the situation to be, of course, very, very troubling. But I think you said, you know, my mom, for instance, is the one who started, who wrote a letter to the president in response to all the attacks against rationalists and the killings, and got hundreds and hundreds of signatures. And in fact, the president addressed that and gave a response to that. But in response to your question, it is very troubling. What is troubling to me is equally troubling as a daughter as it is to me as an Indian. But as you have said before, that you are, as a journalist, you are not afraid of being unpopular. And I think my father, similarly, is not afraid of being unpopular.
And or your mother, in fact.
Or my mother.
Absolutely, and I think that's right.
Javed Saab, on rationalists, the one thing that you have said is that this, what there is great intolerance for is atheists. And you are an atheist. And, you know, that is, in fact, the ultimate holy cow in this country. Have you experienced that? I mean, when you look at Dabolkar, Pansare, Kalburgi.
Well, so far only, they have only burned my effigy. So, as far as...
Good always.
You know, it's interesting. I had a debate with the Mullah from Lucknow, Kalbe Javad, about Parda, and he got very upset with me. So after a few days, on a Friday, I got a call. Somebody, maybe him or maybe his disciple, they said, listen what people are saying. So some slogans were, Javed Akhtar, hai, hai, Javed Akhtar, hai, hai. And then next day I saw a picture that my effigy was being burned. So I sent them a message that it was a very ugly effigy. Next time when you want to burn it, I'll send it to you. So as a matter of fact, as far as religion is concerned, and that includes all the religions, people are extremely intolerant of any objective opinion about it.
Yeah.
And one who doesn't have any freedom of expression in the society is the atheist. You have 20 channels of every religion, of Hindus, of Sikhs, of Muslims, of Christians, not one channel for the atheists.
I think Ruskin's wanting to add something to that.
No, yes, I can add to that. I played safe. I say I'm a God-fearing atheist.
Well, I say thank God I'm an atheist.
But it is here that we come to matters of individual liberty. And let's take this entire controversy, Swapan, I'll start with you, on beef, right? Beef rumors claiming lives in Dadri, beef rumors claiming a life in Jammu and Kashmir, Maharashtra being among states, and I'm not saying this is, again, particular to the BJP. BJP and Congress both have broadly the same position. You have Digvijay Singh proudly claiming that we were the first to actually ban cow slaughter in so many states. But I want to ask, isn't the genuinely liberal position, because there are states in India where you can, in fact, eat beef as in cow meat, isn't the genuinely liberal position to say, if an individual wants to eat any kind of meat, he or she should be able to? Isn't the genuinely liberal position to say the right to love is a personal choice, whether you want to love a man or a woman? The right to love, the right to dress as you want, the right to have sex with who you want, the right to eat the meat you want. Why is nobody standing up for these fundamental personal liberties?
Yeah, I think you've made a very interesting point. And I personally, if you ask my personal opinion, I do believe that everybody has dietary freedom. Unfortunately, in India, and I think this is something which we have to recognize, and you can call it the limitation of Indians, is that this position is a minority position. People will not agree. The reason why there are restrictions in most states of the Indian Union on certain forms of meat, particularly beef, is because society wants it that way. And I think there's no point denying that fact. So, unless Indians themselves suddenly decide, look, we can afford to have a very libertarian position on food, you're going to get restriction. I'll tell you, there are lots of people I know in North India, for instance, who will not have any form of meat cooked at home, but they will happily go out to restaurants. And when they go abroad, their choices expand. But at the same time, they will not. And they will, under no circumstances, will they have any form of meat. Now you enlarge that logic to various communities and they have their own restrictions. And I think we should sometimes respect some of those restrictions and look at people's. We will not, you see, I think, for example, those in Bengal, for instance, there was something called the Young Bengal Movement in the 1830s and 40s. Now, they were rationalists, and some of them were atheists, and one of the ways they thought that they could destroy the stranglehold of the Hindu faith was if you took a piece of beef and threw it at someone's house. Now that's polluted. Now that sort of puerile radicalism, in my view,
fair,
is
absolutely
unacceptable. I think there are certain common decencies and social sensibilities which, however much we may personally disagree, when we live in society, we have to agree. And that's why I call myself a conservative in that sense.
Okay. Just a couple of last comments before we open it up for the audience. Yeah, Javed sir?
You see, religion has a strange kind of a grip on an average person. The fact is, most of the people in the world, including Muslims, Hindus, Christians, they don't live by their book. They don't follow their religion. They don't. But if you ask them whether your religion is right or wrong, they'll say it's right. They will drink alcohol if religion bans it, then too. But if you ask them, sharab haram hai ki nahi? Arey saab, sharab to haram hai. So what happens that when you confront them, they react differently. When you leave them alone, they are different. I don't believe, if you ask any Muslim in India, should we ban pork in this country? He'll say yes. But do you think he really wants it? This is his concern?
Yeah, exactly.
No. The fact is that it is only extreme Hindu beings or extreme Muslim beings who make such issues, and the average person, not for out of respect for these groups, but out of respect for his religion, keep quiet or say, yes, yes, maybe it should be done.
Yeah.
Equally, there are extreme rationalists who say you must eat everything.
No, no, I'm not saying you don't eat anything. As a matter of fact, if you will eat a lot of meat, I'll get less. So I'm happy if you don't eat it. I have no problem.
Okay.
But the fact is that it is imposed on you. Now you have to say what is expected of you. That's all.
Okay, okay. Just quickly, Nandana and Ruskin, last comments, and I want to open it up. Nandana, one of the allegations against liberals that comes from the right of center is that there is selective outrage. That, you know, all the things you listed that you got angry about, where in Bengal people will say, why don't you take the same position on a Taslima Nasreen, or why don't you take the same position on violence in Malda?
I would agree with that.
You would?
I mean, I think there, as I said earlier, it is not really about, it's not, when something is wrong, it is not connected to which state it's happening in, which political party it's seen as being connected to, which time, which year it happened in. If it is an attack on humanity, it's an attack on humanity. But what I would say is that there are so many, there are so many kinds of intolerance in India right now. And one of the things that I was just thinking as we were talking is that it's interesting that the word intolerance has become almost synonymous with religious intolerance. What about intolerance toward women's equality? What about intolerance toward the rights of children? What about intolerance toward homosexuality, toward Dalits?
Yes.
I think...
Yes.
All of those intolerances, we need to think about
those intolerances
as well.
Ruskin, if I can ask you in the end, what is, because children love you, what is the one sort of, you know, not message, but something you'd say to inspire young children today about this republic, about this country on Republic Day? What is the reason to still keep the faith? There are many reasons, but what would be yours?
Oh, to keep the faith.
Hmm? In the country, in the republic, yes, in the idea, yes, of the republic.
Yes. I'd say grow up. So many children I meet and want to be writers too, but when they write, they're sort of writing about life in other lands and with characters. with foreign names, they seem to base them on the books they've read. So I think look into your own, down your own street, in your own town, and look for the good things around you, because there is so much that is good and great in India, and we take it for granted.
Yeah.
And I think
I think that's the perfect note too. And actually, we've proven here that you can have an absolutely civil debate and an intelligent conversation, and nuance is not lost. So before we open it up, a big round of applause for our panel today. I think you've been absolutely wonderful. Thank you so much. All right, I'm going to take questions. Please, no comments, questions, and one per person. And we'll wait for the mic to come to you. Yes, here in the blue, in the fourth row. Yes.
My question is, do you feel...
Just hold your mic closer and ask one person.
My question is to all the panelists, actually.
Start fighting.
I hope not, sir. I hope not. I want to know that, considering we as a people and we as subscribers to today's media, are we who are most responsible for what we are describing as a climate of our country right now? Because we are giving credence to these so-called fringe elements. We are the ones who are giving voices to these elements when we are subscribing to what they have to say. So should we be more responsible as to who we want to hear from?
Swapan, why don't you take that? When does the media decide so-and-so should not get space? You see, if they represent nobody but themselves, maybe. But, you know, for example, when the media gives space to a Sakshi Maharaj or a Yogi Adityanath, sometimes people ask us, why are you giving space to them? But they are members of parliament.
They are members of parliament and they love being outrageous. And I think every parliament in the world have people who love being outrageous. Now, I think, you know, by and large, I would tend to agree that there should be a degree of discernment as far as the media is concerned. Now, but there is a genuine problem here, and I'm sort of standing up for the media. Who should decide whether just because it's a fringe opinion, it's not a relevant opinion?
Yeah.
I mean, precisely the points Nandana made just now. That in the process, you might get a lot of marginal voices,
yeah,
who happen to be very small number,
yeah,
of people.
Yes.
You can also end up subsuming their voices and saying irrelevant. So it's, I think, the articulation of fringe, lunatic sort of concerns is a casualty, is an inevitable consequence of democracy. It's a price which we have to pay.
Yeah.
And, it's really up to the individual. Why, for example, what is really one of the things which has changed in the past 2-3 years has, for instance, the growth of the social media. Now, the social media is very important because it enables ordinary individuals to challenge the media. And one of the reasons why most journalists don't like the social media, although they misuse it themselves, is because social media encourages people to be insolent towards celebrities.
No. That's a reductionist position.
It is a reductionist position, but I'll stick to it.
Okay. We'll have a different debate on it.
The fact is, let me tell you, as a matter of fact, you should look at them with certain sympathy. Most of them are people who have not achieved anything, who are nobody. And this is the time when they can take out, this is the place where can they take out their venom. I think we should cooperate with them and let them abuse us, it doesn't matter at all.
Okay, front row here.
Isn't that what voting is all about?
Voting?
Voting.
I mean, do achievers only vote?
I mean, there is a difference between voting and abusing. I'll show you some of the tweets that I
see. I know they're disgusting. They're disgusting.
Okay, front row here. Yes.
My question to Barkha and Mr. Bond. I've attended the previous session that regarding the award. Okay.
Regarding the
award, the national award.
The awards. Okay. Yes.
So, question is coming here. So, the interviewer Derek asked you the question that why you didn't refuse this particular award is offered by a certain government.
You're talking about the Padma Award.
Padma Award, okay, specifically.
What? So you're saying why were they accepted?
No, my question is this: that don't you feel this particular award?
I already answered that in the last session.
Not really. Don't you feel?
Sir, what's your question? Sharp question.
My sharp question is: don't you feel this particular award given by the government, not any particular political party?
I already answered that. If anyone else wants to answer it, the Padma Award today is seen as politicized. Many Padma awardees on the stage. Does anybody want to take?
I am in a safe position. Padma Shri was given to me when Atalji was the Prime Minister, and Padma Bhushan was given to me when Manmohan Ji was.
Ruskin?
Yes, and the same with me.
Ruskin?
I received the Padma Shri when Mr. Vajpayee was the Prime Minister, and the Padma Bhushan when Mr. Manmohan was the
Prime Okay. But come on. No, 1 minute. No, don't snatch the mic. I will call out to you and only then, there at the back, the gentleman standing. Yes. But you don't have a mic. No, 1 minute.
My question is to all the panelists. In 21st century India, do you think that a degenerated religious identity is the main reason for this rise in intolerance and the counter narrative in intolerance? Because in a deeply religious country, that should not have happened ideally, but that has happened. This is the first part of the question.
No, 1 minute. One question, let's take that. He's actually looking at it from a completely different perspective, that it's actually the degeneration of religious identity. Truly religious societies, this doesn't happen.
Shall I?
You please, as the...
Sir, I may be digressing from the topic a little, but this is something which I would like to share with you. I mean, what is degenerative? You are religious, you are religious. There is no adjective required. The fact is, faith is the problem. What is the difference between faith and belief? I believe there is North Pole. I have not seen it. You can't say that this is my faith that there is North Pole. In spite of the fact, I have not seen it. Because there is a rationale, there is a logic, there is evidence, there is proof, and if I am that desperate, I can go and see it. There can be a witness also. Faith means a belief which does not have rationale, which does not have logic, which does not have evidence, doesn't have any proof, doesn't have any witness. Right? That is faith. Now, I want to know what is the difference between faith and stupidity. Because stupidity also qualifies like that. That you believe something without rational, without logic, without thinking, without any evidence and without any witness.
Okay.
Ultimately, let me complete.
Who's this shouting? Please don't. Huh?
The fact is, faith is collective stupidity. So if you have this kind of stupidity with you, you are prone to make major mistakes.
Okay.
Ma'am, I was cut short, but can I just add on to this?
I actually can't even see where you are.
Because the question was...
No, incomplete. I have to move on. The lady here in the second row, please. We have just a couple of minutes left. Lady here in the second row, can we get her a mic? Ma'am, please stand up, then they can reach a mic to you.
Please. I wanted to ask that the British started this divide and rule. Now, our political parties aren't playing the same Hindu-Muslim, and now they've got Dalit also. Can't we all not be just Indians?
Nandana, do you want to take that? Is it that simple?
Of course, it's not that simple, but it's a good question to ask. I think we've talked about it in different ways today already. If you're saying that our identity as an Indian is being divided in so many ways, and that our loyalties are somehow being forced into corners. I agree with that, but at the same time, it is when there is a particular crime against humanity that happens, you have to, like what happened to Rohit, you know, you cannot possibly say that this is not an issue that's that
and
has to be addressed.
Often the context for violence. So,
yes.
So, I mean, you can't actually wipe that out or blot
you cannot.
It out. Or, you cannot.
It's like saying, can we, you know, there are men and there are women, so their gender doesn't exist as an issue, right? You wouldn't agree with that, would you?
Yeah.
Would you?
I wouldn't want to call it because he was from a different caste. Why can
but
I
what
not
if he was attacked for his caste? I mean, we don't know, and this is
no,
a.
No, but that's
that is what the debate is about.
That is what the debate is about.
There are many who are.
And many who are. There are women today who are not allowed into temples. There are Dalits who are not allowed into temples. So we're not all Indians with the same rights. The day we are, maybe we can
so
say
if
that.
If
you know?
We are not being aware of the ways in which the underprivileged are being marginalized, then we are not in a way being Indian, are we? Because that's what we started off talking about that.
Okay, last two questions. A question here in the front row. Please stand so we can get you the mic. He can identify you more easily.
This question is to the entire panel, including the computer person. I know I won't get a fair answer, but still I'm asking.
Okay, what's the question?
The question is that is all this debate, etc., a very clever ploy to actually hide the issue? Because after all, we get a lot of intolerances. You know, Chennai floods, the fact that the first fortnight of January was very warm, this fortnight is actually getting colder and colder. And why all this award acceptance and award WAPSI in the first place?
No, what's the question? You're saying it's irrelevant.
It's actually, I think, a very clever ploy to hide the actual issues that are going to come in the next few months.
Well, how
and you are sitting here, wasting time.
I think Mr. Bond wants to take that.
No.
How could you be here? You must go and face the real issues.
Ruskin.
Well, I want to ask one question.
No, that's it. Mr. Bond, you wanted to come in on that.
I got to say, how do we hide the issue by sitting here and talking about it?
Yeah, exactly. And he's sitting here too, so that has to be said. Okay, how can you? All right, last question here in the green. Yeah, please stand up. Yeah. Last question. I'm sorry, I'm out of time. Yes.
To the panel, my only question is a fundamental question. Has the Indian nation evolved or evolving around the constitution?
Swapan, I think you should take that. Is it evolved or evolving around the constitution? And do you revise your opinion about constitutional patriotism not being the defining principle?
No, I don't revise it because I think India predated 26 January 1950. India wasn't born either on August 15, 1947 or on 26 January 1950. It predated it. The idea of what constitutes political nationhood has been shaped by these subsequent definitions. But there is a larger sense of a cultural Indianness. And incidentally, that question which was asked about irrationality of faith or something like that, most of Indians don't actually follow faith as such. What they actually adhere to is a form of inheritance. This is parampara. In other words, religion, culture, everything, politics is all enmeshed together, and the neat divisions which exist in the West don't exist in India. There are far more overlapping categories, and we have to recognize that.
I want to add to that. I agree with you. India did not evolve with the constitution. It has existed for centuries, and so has a tradition of tolerance. So, in response to your question, we have had very prominent leaders from the time of Ashoka who have made it very clear that it's important to have equal distance between different religions and the government.
Bad example.
I'm sorry?
Ashoka is a bad example because Ashoka was the first person who actually put a faith as part of the state.
Yes,
beliefs.
But he also...
That was the wrong
example. I'm sorry. I will go to that. He is the first person who also said that we have to hear the other point of view. It is not a bad example of... I mistakenly said Ashoka. I actually meant Akbar. But Ashoka is another good example of someone who did insist on the importance of having opposing points of view. And Akbar was someone
who... As a matter of fact, we don't need anybody or any king to tell us how to live. We know that. The fact
The fact is, Indians with so many religions, so many languages, so many subcultures, so many regional interests and identities have for thousands of years have lived together, and they will live together.
And engaged in continuous dialogue.
I do have to close, but I'll give the last word to the God-fearing atheist.
What can I say? tolerance, yes. I'm very cautious. You know, I looked it up in the dictionary before coming. And it says, tolerance, enduring with patience, is the exact meaning.
Yes.
So let's endure with patience. Otherwise, we all become intolerant.
Thank you so much. May I ask everybody to, as we close, it would be fitting, I think, to end this with just a few strains of the national anthem. So can we please ask everybody to rise for the national anthem? And somebody has to lead in singing it, because I'm tone deaf. Javed Saab.
जनगण मन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल बंगो विंध हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्छल जलधि तरंगो तब शुभ नामी जागे तब शुभ आशीष मांगे जाहे तब जयो गाथा जनगण मंगल दायक जयो हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जयो हे जयो हे Jayo, 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 hey.
Thank you.
Right for another year, but before we leave, may we have a quick word of thanks from the curator of Victoria Memorial Hall, Dr. Jayant Sen Gupta, who has actually made this all possible.
Extraordinary literary meet. Thank you so much, our wonderful panelists, Mr. Ruskin Bond, Mr. Javed Akhtar, Mr. Swapan Dasgupta and Ms. Nandana Sen, and thank you so much, Ms. Barkha Dutt, for moderating this exhilarating panel discussion. And ladies and gentlemen, that brings down the curtains on this year's edition of the Tata Steel Kolkata Literary Meet. I'm sure you will all agree that it has been an extraordinary 5.5 day long extravaganza of high quality conversations, which turned this little space into virtually a microcosm of the global republic of letters. It's been an absolute privilege to co-host this meet for the third year running. And on behalf of everybody in the Victoria Memorial Hall, I'm deeply grateful to my co-host, Ms. Malavika Banerjee, director of this meet, for bringing it here and for keeping it here. I also thank Tata Steel, the chief sponsor of the meet, for helping us to grow bigger and better. And no words, of course, are adequate to describe the sterling dedication with which the teams Kalam and Victoria Memorial have worked together for weeks to gear up for this meet. And finally, thank all of you in this wonderful, wonderful audience for coming here in hordes to make the meet such a grand success. In fact, nothing testifies more tellingly to the fact that we are getting bigger and better than all the flowers that lie quashed on the perimeter walls of this sitting arena. We knew that the pain was mightier than the sword, but we have now discovered that it trumps the power of flowers as well. But please don't worry, it's not for nothing that we are the cleanest monument in India. So I promise that many, many more flowers will bloom here, right here, as you come back next year for next year's Kolkata Literary Meet. Thank you very much. Good night, and see you next year. Thank you.
Do you want to announce that?